identity. And I've seen, like, I've experienced these things like so closely. Like, I've witnessed it, like people changing their names only because, oh, okay, and during that time I changed the name because mere maa baap ko kuch na bolo. And like sasural walon ne bola ki mujhe change karna hai. So it's not about just the surname. I've witnessed people changing their names. Like, my mom has changed her own name. And she couldn't say anything even if she wanted to, because in the end there is this guilt that, you know, the society puts on, like, oh, mere maa baap ko bolenge, like kya sanskar hai diye, and all that shit that comes up. So I mean, it shouldn't be a big deal if she wants to take her name. I mean, obviously it's coming from 150 years of colonization and other sick mentalities which this whole system has like effed up. But still, it shouldn't be a big deal if she wants to take her husband's name, or if she wants to be a freaking princess consular banana hammock, right? So it should be an individual's choice. And in this case, it should be her choice, because it clearly she is not, like, this whole thing is based on gender. She's not treated as an individual. She's treated as a woman, and that's the problem. So I think that's the sum up of this whole chapter.
Right. She also gives this example of this Shobha Hemvati Davies, who was a kind of, her father was from an upper class Hindu family, but her mother was from a scheduled tribe. And to be in the election, to be elected, one had to be of the scheduled caste. And so she appealed in the court that my mother was from the scheduled caste. My father left me at the age of maybe 5. And since then, my mother has been taking care of me. So technically, I should be taking my mother's surname and not my father's, because I was not born. I was, you know, born to him, but they separated. So what about the separation, since these guys didn't get divorced? Because divorce is another stigma. And people separate, but they do not file a divorce. So the Supreme Court, of course, did not listen to her and said that you are, you know, playing this victim card by kind of talking your mother off as a concubine and, putting your children, your other siblings under the scheduled caste when they're not. So this is something that, another example she gives in another chapter, about how patrilineal is passed on. Another thing that she highlights in another chapter is how there's a patrilineal society. In this patrilineal society, there are certain government and NGOs that take up the marriages of women. They get them married, they pay for the marriage expenses, they pay for they pay the dowry also to the man's family. So the whole idea that you are being married on the government's expense, so the government takes the role of a father, and then they make it mandatory that a woman has to be married, that this is the ultimate to a woman. And this money that is spent by the government, and especially she mentions about Mukhyamantri Kanyadan Yojana that was started in Madhya Pradesh, and subsequently that led to virginity tests happening, because a lot of married couple also started coming in for the wedding gifts. So there was a virginity test that was done on women to check, because of course if she's unmarried, she'll be a virgin. That kind of a conception was also there, also in Kashmir.
Guaranteeing the chastity of a woman.
Right. And then in Kashmir, you see that a woman loses the right to the citizenship of Jammu and Kashmir if she marries outside the state. So another woman coming in from the outside is accepted and given the rights, but a woman who wants to marry outside, she can't retain the property rights. So she has a property on her name. If she gets married, that property is lost. So another person said, she mentions that there was a talk that since women coming from the outside are given the citizenship rights, then of course the woman, kind of it balances off, and there is nothing wrong that is happening it against women, because we lose some women, we gain some women. So that is the whole, it's still there. And it is really someone from probably like one of my friends. She's not here. Her father was a Kashmiri and married outside. He never lost the property rights. Getting it. He still, you know, he married outside, he did, but he still has the property rights. So yeah, that is something that she highlights in another chapter. So maybe we can move on to Janvi. Janvi, you summarize your next chapter.
Yes, sure. So, okay, this part of the chapter is called Changing Forms of Hindu Family. Now, it is very politically driven and, you know, it states a lot of laws and the legitimization and delegitimizations of various practices and all of that, which is not my strong suit. So, I will focus on these different playful parts of the chapter. And first of all, I would like to start by deconstructing the title itself, which is Changing Forms of Hindu Family. So two important words in the title itself are Hindu and family. What is a Hindu and what is a family? So she has written in the chapter that India recognizes a Hindu as anyone who is not a Muslim, a Christian, and a Parsi. So this is how we define a Hindu person or a Hindu community in India. Second is, what is family? I think there are two major agencies that define what a family is. The first being marriage and the second being property, I think. And so we can discuss it now in the chapter. In the initial part of the chapter, she gives us an example as she herself belongs to the Nayar community of Kerala. She states that her own house was actually matrilineal until the generation of her grandmother, where the brother and the sister, they lived together with the sister's children while the father of the children lived with his sisters and their children. Now, it may seem a little awkward or inappropriate to us, but that is how things have been in her practice. And she also mentions this example in the Khasi culture. I hope Nappi can maybe, you know, say something about it later. So she says that in the Khasi culture, the youngest daughter in the house is given the property, she inherits a property because she is supposed to take care of the fathers and in their old age, while the husband of the girl shifts in with her in her own house, in her father's and in her parents' house. So so she sets these things apart. So now she brings in the first law, which is the Hindu Code Bill, and this bill was, I think, passed in 1955 and 1956. What this basically does is grants women a few rights to choose their partner for marriage, whether inside or from outside their community, and it grants them some rights regarding divorce and property in that they should inherit the husband's property, so many feminists they claim that one of the goals of this kind of bill was to bring uniformity among, you know, various practices, to actually to codify them as a measure of national integration rather than actually giving women any rights. Because there is an assumption that bringing about uniformity as such is a progressive measure, but it is very problematic, you know, she herself states that. She very interestingly gives us an instance it sounds like a play. So there's an instance which is of an exchange in a parliament during the debate on property rights for women, including the devolution. So the passage says there's this first character, Mukut Bihari Lal. He argues against property rights for daughters. And he gave as a supporting reason the fact that no Hindu parent would want to inherit a daughter's property in the event of her death. To this, our another character, L. Krishna Swami Bharati, asked, why not? Why not? What's the harm? So another MP called Bhargava, agreeing with Lal, the first character, responded, perhaps my honorable friend comes not from India, but from some outside country. To which Bharati says, I come from south of India. Bhargava, in India, no father or mother will ever think of receiving anything from the daughter. Bharati, that may be so in the Punjab. Bhargava says again, it is so in the whole of northern India. Therefore, the entire fabric of the rules of devolution is based on anti-Hindu ideals. So just a second. Yeah, so there's this, I think, another instance as well. Another instance of such a disregard for practices in the South is visible in S.P. Mukherjee's comment speaking against making divorce less complicated. So he states, somebody said that South India was specially progressive and many of the laws we are considering are already in existence here today. I say, good luck to South India. Let South India proceed from progress to progress, from divorce to divorce. Why force it on others who do not want it? So I think this clearly gives us a ground where there is such a distinction, a major distinction in practices in North India and South India. And I think through many of such bills and laws that are passed in the parliament, the culture of the North India is homogenized over the entire fabric of, our country, India. So I think I can bring in the second, So what all this has, so what this also brings in is the homogenization of the ceremony, such as of marriage. So it brings in this Saptapadi, which is a marriage ceremony. A Brahmanical marriage ceremony. But the fallout for this is, in this instance, say, although, bigamy is outlawed in India, but it is very difficult to prove that a bigamous man has done a second marriage if the second marriage is not done according to the stated ceremonial marriage of the Hindus, which is the Saptapadi style, where they go around the sacred fire and take seven these things. So if if the marriage has happened in any other than the prescribed ceremony of marriage, then it is not considered. So, in this manner, it gets difficult to prove in a court that, the event has happened at all. And I think the major three features of a Indian family are, first, patriarchy, which is the distribution of power, as we have said it over and over, that in a common Hindu family, the adult male has more power than the elderly female of the house. And patrilineage is where the property and the name is passed on from father to the son. And virilocality, where the wife moves to the husband's home. And what happens in these instances of the last two features, which is patrilineality and virilocality, is that it leaves a woman or a female member dependent on the husband or the or the brother, because she is departed from her inheritance of her natal home, and she is hardly given any rights in the property of her husband's home as well. So it is, you know, a kind of an important measure in the employment of patriarchy as an institution in our country. So I think the Hindu Code Bill, I'll add this again, the Hindu Code Bill gives women right to a part in their husband's property after their husband's death. But what happens is, because this homogenizes, throughout all the cultures, where there is an exception, there are many exceptions, such as the Jains. They already have, much developed and higher measures in such cases where the wife of the husband is a preferential heir to the son, to her son itself. So these are, completely neglected, and they are actually surpassed by this uniformity that the laws are trying to bring on in the name of progress, I think. So yeah, I think more or less this is what the chapter, talks about.
Yeah, so we can move to Preeti now. Preeti, is she there?
Hi, yes, I'm here. Hi, everybody. This is Preeti Roy. I am doing my master's. I'm in my third semester from Bangalore University. I'm right now staying in Bangalore. So today my topic is on, the chapter is on new reproductive technologies, a challenge to patrilineal. So, here Menon talks about the new technological, hello, am I audible? Okay. Yeah. So she talks about the new technological developments in the reproductive science, which made it possible for any couple in this generation to have kids of their own. And she even talks about the aspects, different aspects of the biological experience of the motherhood, which has been changed after this new development. So she categorizes it in three different categories, like the woman, because how society looks at a woman is she should be performing. She can be the mother, she can give birth to her own child, and she will be the social mother, in the sense she'll be nurturing her kid and she'll help them grow up. But because of this new technological development, which is basically IVF, is in vitro fertilization. So now Menon is categorizing the motherhood in three different parts. So I'll try to mention them quickly. So she's saying, I term the key mother functions, providing genetic material. So a woman who will provide the genetic material, which is the egg donor, who is the egg donor. And there is the second category she's categorizing is gestating the fetus for the 9 months, means the surrogate, means the gestational mother, means who is going to carry the baby and give birth, but she is not going to claim the baby. She's not going to raise the baby. And the third is the social mother, who is going to bringing up the child. So now this three ways a motherhood or function of a mother has been divided. So she even says that in older biological understanding of motherhood, these three functions are assumed to be fused in one woman, but now there could be two or three women performing these three separate roles in each pregnancy. So now in the second part, she talks about how this the companies who are advertising these, IVF, in vitro fertilization, who takes care of all these, for their cheap advertising the attempt. So they are advertising the point now the couple who cannot have their own child because of anybody's lackness, whether the father, whether the mother. So you can have your own biological child rather than adopting. So that concept she brings in here, Menon. Before adaptation was the next option. Any parent could, any couple could go for to raise, if they are willing to raise a kid. But now these companies, just for the commercial, their need or commercial advertisement, they are putting this point forward. And because of this patrilineal, everybody is tend to getting more attracted towards these offers because they are getting very well convinced that, okay, now we can have our own biological child. The concept of own biological child, and that is our own child, not somebody if we adopt is not our own child. That mentality has been giving a lot of importance. She brings this topic also here, which is happening. And then she gives limelight to these points also, ki now because of these development in the reproductive science, how the in the society, the people who can have their who can have child has increased, in the sense a woman who doesn't want to get married but still she wants to have her own kid, a single mother, she wants to be, she can have through a surrogate mother. Even she talks about homosexuals couple, so they can also claim, they can have their own child. And like this, she talks, it has been in a broader perspective, every category people, the couples can have now their own child. One second, another thing she, here another thing she talks about, it is also important to open up and unravel the very idea of biologically related families. So now, being in a Hindu society, being an Indian, we lot of time must have observed this. Already we see ki our grandparents maybe sometime comment, oh, tu to chokri hai. You know, like to the guy, to the family, I mean, if there is a boy in the family, they'll, grandparents, they're like, you know, pyar and all will increase towards them. And so now she is bringing this thing in, how adaptation, if you adopt, if a couple adopt a kid, so mentality should work for a couple same way, na, ki if they are so willing to have their own kid, which they're unable to produce for some reason, which everybody is sorry for. But if their mentality is to grow a child, how is this mentality working in the society? Ki, okay, having our own child, that this option is so important to everybody, rather than adopting somebody and that is not our own blood, which is where she talks about dissent. Yeah, the people, it has become hello. So hello, am I audible?
Yes.
So here they talk about how the definition of deciding the dissent and, you know, who should be our higher has also mattered. It should only be biological, biologically related, our genes. So the last part where she talks about She talks about another thing about women. There are these poor women who are being targeted. They are basically commercially, it is being used that they will be paid certain amount and they can be the surrogate and they can give birth to child. And which a lot of rich people can afford because these agencies are coming in between. So they are kind of, it has been established in a very commercial way that they want to, channelize it. And it's a business to create child. And she's telling a lot of poor women are being targeted. And these women are also accepting those offers because it's a good amount for them. Because they so she terms this particular word either surrogate are used, their womb are used as an oven, means where you cook a food and you have it happily. So the oven, so or a rented room. So they are being used these ways according to Menon, and she has talked about that. And basically she wants to say ki how these agencies or companies are convincing people and they're playing with their with couple's mind and society's mind and how we are also getting into it and we are deciding everything like that way, that manner. Yeah. And okay, so another thing she talks about finally, she concludes ki as we have seen already, biological relationships are also socially constructed. Like most technological developments, then the social implications of surrogacy would vary from context to context. The family is an institute that rigidly enforces systems of inheritance and descent. And in this structure, individuals, sons, daughters, wives, husbands, are resources that are strictly bounded by the violence implicit and explicit of this frame. So, and then she ends it with, we tend to take this frame for granted and it becomes absently visible only in extraordinary circumstances. Yeah, I hope I made sense.
Preeti, of course, yeah. So I was wondering, we have another session left and the meeting has been going from like 2 hours. So me and Asabri was thinking of taking it post lunch, probably at 4 o'clock.
Yeah. Sure.
What do you guys suggest?
We can have the discussion post lunch, probably 3 or 4 o'clock
would be fine. 2 hours of break is necessary because this is a lot of
there was a lot of information and new things have opened up. And yeah, I think it would be good if we talk about it. We will be able to
know.
Right. So
I'd like to say a sentence.
Yeah.
I'd like to take a minute. I wanted to comment on how, when Priyanshi was talking about the topic where after marriage, women are supposed to, mold into the husband's family as well as take their surname as the last name. So there I wanted to make a point. It is in my family, my mom had to take, obviously according to the rule, in the sense like the society rule, she had to take up my father's surname, which led to a lot of problem issues still now. It's been, they are married from like last 30, 35 years maybe. So my mom's surname was initially Biswas and my father's surname is Roy. So she had all the documents and she kind of got married quite late, like in the sense 29 to 30. So by the time she had her job and she had her bank accounts and every legal documents with her name. But after the marriage, she had daddy's surname. So this led to a lot of fuss and a lot of issue till now. Bank people, if she needs to do, some changes in her bank issue or something, she has to go, she has to take help of her law, a lawyer or something, because she has to go through affidavit. Basanti Biswas and Basanti Roy Biswas is the same person. Get it? So there is so much unnecessary. I feel it's really unnecessary.
Yeah, definitely. Preeti, also, I don't know, probably the kind of dilemmas I have to go through when I'm filling an official form. So abhi mother's name has been added, but otherwise it's always been, you know, father's name mandatory or things like those, documentation, what is required to be documented. And I spoke to my mother about this. I had a conversation, and what do you think? You changed your surname. So she said, for me, not changing my name, keeping my name was revolutionary, because according to the, you know, that marriage ceremony, you have to, when you enter into a new family, or
they decide your name or something like that.
Yeah, they give you a new name. So she held on to her own name. So for her, that was revolution. So I guess that idea dheere is coming, but again, what's in a name? That exactly. Question sort of lingers. Yeah. So that is there. And also what you spoke about today, you know, it's something also that this again goes to the idea of nurturing, for holding a baby, those kind of things. And there is another chapter, probably we will talk about it later, where can men also lactate, like they can feed a baby. So we will go later, but it's all connected. I think even what Janhvi spoke about, you know,
everything is interconnected, and
everything is interconnected. And family, I mean, it's an institution, and you are required to be in a certain way, right? Be an ideal boy or an ideal girl or something.
Exactly.
Like that.
I wanted to tell that, I mean, the topic I talked about, same thing, like even in my locality, there is a situation where this small kid is adopted. So first of all, she was never told. At the same time, the family didn't tell their grandparents, in the sense, like, suppose the couple, they could not reveal this to their own parents, and the father's side of the parents, right? The husband's side of the parents. Why? Because they will not accept.
कोकणी में बोलते हैं आमच्या घराचा दिवो दिवो, मतलब हमारे घर का दिया, वंश आगे लेके जाएगा. सो वेयर आर दोज आइडियाज कमिंग अप, यू नो.
एग्जैक्टली. And another thing, I just wanted to know if your idea, what is your like idea about this? So Menon talks about this concept of surrogacy, which scientific revolutions has always been, you know, it always has its pros and causes. Every revolution has. So it is up to the human, ultimately, how do we accept it and how do we lead it to? So that shows whether it's in a positive way or negative way. The surrogacy thing is, of course, it has been really helpful for a lot of couple who has been waiting to have their own kid. At the same time, and she talks about the donor thing, right? Now it has become like a single donor can give a lot of people their child. This can lead to sometime, and now they talk about any gay couple, any lesbian couple, everybody can have their own child because of this surrogacy thing has come into development.
Yeah.
But there is this thing in Hindu society, we have this concept, we cannot get married within the family, right? Like we cannot get married to our cousins, we cannot get married to our blood related, any which is like at least 2-3 generation something. Although I
my
know
case,
in South
India, we are supposed to get married to a guru.
There is
a
what?
guru
left.
Yeah.
So we can
anyway.
If we want to continue discussion on family, we can do that, and then we'll join at 4 to talk about body, because I really feel we need time to process what we have.
Yeah, right.
Yes, yes. Let's conclude. Priti,
okay, and we talk about family right now also. We can extend it about family. If somebody wants to add something here, and then conclude.
Yeah, so I'll just very quickly, I'll finish that, what I want to ask everyone. Because according to the history of science, there was this community in South Africa who were getting connected. They were having child among each other. Okay, but then that community started having growing to have a lot of diseases, genetic disorders. And ultimately, scientists came up with this conclusion because these all the genes were getting mixed, similar genes in the sense like the brother sister. So the like this kind of. I hope you can understand what I'm trying to say. So my question is, if this donor thing and it comes in a, you know, in a trend, even if somebody doesn't want to give birth, right? A female can wish not to decide not to give birth or something for her bodily change or whatever her, whatever she decides.
It's going to
end
any minute. So if,
yes.
If people can join in again, I can start the meeting again and we can continue this discussion further if
I think we can pretty